Welcome to Season 5 of Coffee with Dr. Stewart. This show will provide our listeners with up-to-date medical information from a leading neurologist and genomic specialist. I invite you to sit back, grab your favorite beverage or cup of coffee, and let's have Coffee with Dr. Stewart. Welcome, everybody, to a special episode of Coffee with Dr. Stewart. I am your host, Kara Stewart-Mullins, and I am here to talk to our medical providers of genomics nutrition. Hi, everyone. Hi, Dr. Stewart. How are you?
Hello, Kara.
We have some exciting news. I feel like we always have exciting news, but this is really exciting.
Yes.
So for those of you who have been with us through this journey of nutrigenomics and releasing panels and the 55 report and all that fun stuff, well, we are making a huge change as of May 1st. The company name is actually changing, right, Dr. Stewart?
Yep.
Okay, so genomics nutrition just really didn't make sense to us anymore. Due to the fact that we're going to be getting into pharmacogenetics, we're going to be getting into blood work, we're going to be doing lots of things. We just opened our lab here in Austin, Texas, and we have made an announcement that we will now be called GX Sciences, and we're a company that's going to offer innovative genomic solutions, right?
That's correct.
Okay, so as of May 5th, and this will be a formal announcement to everybody, that's our new company. Going to be GX Sciences, still going to be able to offer everything that we have now, but we are bringing out 13 genetic panels.
Yeah,
wow.
Basically, what happened is, you know, the nutrigenomics space is exploding.
Exploding, yes.
And I can't tell you how many emails I get with people wanting me to look at specific SNPs. And so we felt like it was to our best interest to actually upgrade the lab. And so, you know, previously, if you knew, we had a lab in San Antonio. And so what we did is we upgraded the lab, moved it to Austin, upgraded the machinery. We're trying to get a turnaround of 5 to 10 days as opposed to 2 to 3 weeks.
Right.
And hopefully even less than 5 days if we really
we'll get
do it
there,
well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And we also realized that when you start adding new genes, you need to have control of the project.
Yeah.
And so what happened is we, Kara and I ran into a gentleman that used to work for our uncle. Our uncle was a founder of a lab called CPL, which is Clinical Pathology Laboratories. And this gentleman, Mike Willoughby, had been in the lab sector for over 20 years, and we just kind of hit it off, and it made sense, and boy, he runs a world-class lab. And
it's already up and running.
We should. We would love for you to come over and actually tour our lab.
Yeah, it's right here in South Austin.
Because I think you will be blown away. The couple of doctors that have just come to town for different reasons that I took over there were completely blown away.
We've got a new PhD on staff, an amazing laboratory director.
And so if you have any PhD questions, we have a wonderful Dr. Steve Finkbeiner.
Yeah.
And Steve comes from New Orleans, so don't hold it against him, but he is your ultimate genetic PhD. He's also a biochemist, so he's one of those guys that actually we can stun each other. So
that's hard to do. That's very hard to do.
So
if you know Dr. Stewart,
he's just a great guy, easy to talk to. We will have him presenting at some of our lectures, just our workshops, just kind of showing what's happening. But here's what happens. So we basically have expanded the panel to 115 to 120 currently.
Genes.
And so when we have a panel of 120 genes, it's 55 is overwhelming enough.
Right.
We still will be offering the 55 for people if they choose to have it, because that's kind of an all-encompassing piece. But what we found out was that with this 120, we could offer a whole lot more functionality to the provider. Now, here's the problem. When you start going to 120 genes, or more than that, which it's going to be eventually, all of a sudden you're offering a cost point that is just not appropriate for the patient. And so after we kind of brainstormed on it, what they asked me to do was to take the 120 and divide it essentially into 13 different panels.
Right.
And so those panels will, when we see the patient, we will actually run the entire 120 genes and stick them in a database. Mm-hmm. So we have all that information in the database. But what we're going to then do is, according to how you what you desire in that patient, we will reach in and grab the panel that you specifically want and report that to the patient. And we have new software being developed, and I think it will be much more functional for you. It will also be much more self-explanatory, I guess is a good way to put it. In fact, we're going to work very hard. Our new software works very hard on the summary page to try to simplify the process. But the ones that we're going to actually talk about today are what I call the major panels. And those major panels, there's currently 6 to 7 of them. Depends on how you want to look at it.
Right.
And then we have the minor panels, which basically you can subdivide into GI.
I was just going to read. Let me just go ahead and tell you what these panels are. We're going to talk about what I call the core panels. There's like you said, about 4 or 5. We're going to talk about 3 of them today. But we've got foundation, methylation, wellness, which is a panel in itself, immune, autoimmune, neurological, psych, neurotransmitter, chronic pain, which I think is huge, mm-hmm. gastrointestinal, autophagy panel, detoxification, developmental, women's health, men's health, pre-surgical, diet and wellness, and then, of course, still offering the 55 SNP report.
Sure.
Wow.
Yep.
You've been working really hard. I know that.
Driving me crazy.
Okay. Well, since everybody understands methylation, that's what, you know, you're known as the methylation doc. Mm-hmm. And all the workshops, you know, it's always a discussion. Let's start there. So I've got the new panel report in front of me.
Okay.
And it's pretty cool because it's all color-coded, the pluses, the minuses. It's got the recommended nutrients, you know, recommended formulas, provider discretion, lifestyle recommendations, laboratory recommendations, health precautions.
Right.
Gives you a lot more information than we currently have on our report. So break that down for us.
Okay. So this is stuff that if you've used our testing, you're all familiar with. This is the entire process of methylation from folate 1 and 2 all the way through MTHFR.
Okay.
We've also included the SLC19A1, which is the reduced folate carrier, solute carrier. And so we will get a very good feel for methylfolate metabolism in the first section. So what we did is we went ahead and divided the methylfolate metabolism from the methyl B12 metabolism.
Okay.
SNPs.
You separated them on the report.
Separated
in this panel particularly. Mm-hmm.
And so we've got the FOLR1 and 2, dihydrofolate reductase, MTHFD1, MTHFR, both forms, and then the SLC1981. And then when we got to the B12 metabolism, we have MTRR,
right,
which is the recycling of methionine reductase, the B12 for methionine reductase. And so that will tell you whether you need methyl B12 to help the methionine replenishment. And then you have gastric intrinsic factor, TCN1 and 2. And
wow.
So that will tell us about cellular delivery, intestinal delivery of B12. And it just basically gives us an idea of a problem with any of the B12 transport from food all the way through. Then we went ahead and put the VDR TAC in there, and I've been asked why I don't put the BSM in. When you look at VDR TAC and BSM, I've only seen one report out of, well, actually two reports out of 7,000 where those were different.
Really?
Okay. And so if one of them's heterozygous, the other one's heterozygous. And so when we're trying to conserve wells, so if you know anything about
genetic testing,
typically most machines work on a 64 or 128 well plate. And so we can't use the corner plates because they're partial plates, so we have 60 wells.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we're trying to decide, because literally I have 140 SNPs that I could
right,
use.
I know.
And so we decided to compress it to 115 just to make sure we launch this as we go.
Right.
And so it just didn't make sense to add a SNP that's always the same as the other one.
Right.
So that's why we stuck with the VDR TAC.
Which is extremely important.
And you can just trust it.
Right.
Okay. And then we have all the mitochondrial respiratory.
Yeah, this is why I want to ask you. So, you know, I'm so used to seeing mitochondria separate, and mm-hmm. I always just looked at it separate. Why is it on the methylation panel?
It's not the methylation panel. It's actually, this is the foundation wellness.
Foundation wellness panel.
Meaning that everybody needs gasoline, everybody needs oil.
Makes sense.
Everybody needs vitamin D.
Right.
And everybody needs to know how good their batteries work.
I love that this is on this one panel.
Just one panel.
This
so this is for
panel.
All people, no matter healthy, sick, whatever.
21 genes.
Because a lot of people viewed the GX Nutrition or genomics nutrition report, the 55 is a sick person's panel. Do you understand?
Yeah.
People started to kind of get that, but this is a little panel that
obviously... I'd say it's little because it's 21 genes and it's a lot of information.
It's a panel that really tells us about your general wellness and how we can help you maintain that.
Okay.
Without getting deep into markers that predict bad things.
Okay. I gotcha.
Or inadequate things. I wouldn't say bad.
So getting back to the mitochondrial that's on this panel with the methylation.
So this is the entire respiratory chain.
Nice.
Okay. And these are the ones that are very, very common, and it actually will define exactly what you need and whether you need it or not. And in a general rule for me, if you've ever been to one of my workshops, you can see that I have a methodology to determine the strength of the mitochondria. It is not scientifically accurate, but it works clinically very well.
Right.
And in essence, it basically will tell us whether we need mitochondrial assistance or not.
Okay.
And that's pretty much what it is.
Now, getting to the lifestyle recommendations and the laboratory recommendations, which we've never had on the 55 report. Okay, a little bit here and there, but those are added columns. So tell us about those.
Okay, so I don't know if any of you know about the laboratory industry. We've gotten a tremendous amount of insight from Mr. Willoughby, our executive that's over the lab. You will be shocked at how much the margins are for the laboratories that go through insurance.
They make a lot of money.
He tells us, and it makes perfect sense, that the biggest hassle for most people is getting access for the laboratory draw to the patient. And so there are some new devices out. In fact, one of them is called the TAP system, where you actually put a little device on your shoulder, you push a button, and it painlessly removes a specific amount of plasma.
Takes
about 5 minutes.
Oh, 5 minutes.
Yeah,
okay.
And that you can do it at home. And what we've decided to do is, which will be later this summer, bring in devices so that we can offer people or practitioners testing that the patients don't have to go to a specific lab. And we've also decided to bring the price way down to where they...
an affordable cash price.
Where they can do it for cash, because it's just atrocious. Mr. Willoughby will actually tell us, and since I'm talking to providers, he will tell us that in the third quarter, the board would meet for most laboratories, and if they were behind, they'd just jack up the patient prices.
Because they can.
And so whatever the insurance didn't pay, they could bill the patients.
Right.
And then when the new year came around, they jacked the prices back down.
That doesn't surprise me. It's business. But the one thing that I like about, so if you wanted to do a drop ship to a patient to get their genetics, ran before your appointment.
Sure.
You can put in the
laboratories.
The laboratory, this TASO that you're talking about, to send with the kit to their house. They can put that on their arm, draw the blood, they can swab themselves, and then they can ship it to our lab and everything is ran.
That's correct.
And you have all the results and information you need on that patient prior to the appointment.
That's correct.
That is amazing.
Yes.
I hate to go to the blood draw place.
Well, I do too.
And take your child. I mean, we don't know how well a child's going to, with autism or something, would sit with that on their arm. But
they're a little sensory. We have tried it a little bit.
Right.
They do seem to do fine.
Okay.
A lot of times we move back around to the back a little bit. And
where they may not notice.
Yeah, and it actually feels
pretty amazing.
I mean, you can feel it, but it's not painful.
You know, like I always say, this is the future, people. You know, it's the future of genetics and blood draw and everything that we're doing.
And we also will have a finger prick method. So the dry blood spot is nasty.
Right. It's hard.
It's hard. There also are some other devices to gather it up very cleanly.
Mm-hmm.
And, so this is where we're headed, but we're going to be offering a lot of laboratories that you want so that we can try to service as many people as we can.
Right.
And make your life easier.
And there's a lot of providers out there that should be able to order a blood draw that can't.
Sure.
So, let the people that are the functional medicine
clinicians. And in fact,
clinicians.
If your patient wants it from anybody, you can have them order.
Right. And another thing, too, I just want to make sure that everybody's clear. This is testing that's only offered through the providers. I get that question all the time. Do you offer this to consumers? No, this is a provider-only test. I want to make that our tagline. Providers, provider orders for providers, you know, this testing for providers, because
Correct. It
needs to be in the hands of the providers, because it's a lot of information on the patient
Correct.
To get them well or to get that prevention.
Correct.
Tell me about the lifestyle recommendations column.
Well, the lifestyle recommendations comes, as far as the methylation wellness, there's not very many.
Okay.
But when you get into the other panels, there are certain situations, certain markers where you may need to avoid certain nutritional elements. You may
like with
need
the GI panel?
Yeah, you may need to avoid certain drugs, or
right.
you may expect something doesn't quite work as well because of that marker. You also, when we get into the diet panel eventually, we mm-hmm. will be able to tell you exactly what type of exercise is best for your genes.
Right, that's exciting.
We'll be able to tell you exactly what type of diet is best for your genes
mm-hmm.
instead of you just talking to your girlfriends and
this worked for me
out.
And I lost 40
yeah,
pounds.
Or going to Pinterest and saying, oh, look at this cool diet. And then it also will tell us about the diet panel is really in particular very fun. We're not
right.
talking about that today, but it also tells us the typical dietary supplements and whether they work for you.
Right.
And so that's a good one. But like, for instance...
Well, let's get into the next core panel.
Okay.
Let's get into the immune, autoimmune panel.
Okay.
You know, I love this one because, gosh, I don't know what it is. Maybe it's just because I'm in the industry, but autoimmune is just taking over the world.
Well,
and everybody's got something with that.
There's probably reasons for that, which we can talk about some other
right.
time. But what has really happened, this is probably the panel that has changed the most. There are, if you've been to my workshop, you understand that I talk about on switches and off switches mm-hmm. and control of inflammation. We have a lot of new interleukin markers that can give us a lot better feeling for people and their particular risk or need for us to control inflammation. And so in addition to the ones that you've typically seen, we have interleukin-6, we have the TRAF-1, we have the SOCS, we have the interleukin-23R, interleukin-2RA.
A lot of new ones.
IRF-5, DRD-2. These are, the DRD-2 is really interesting because when you're a practitioner who's an MD or a DO, low-dose naltrexone is something we use, and
right.
we can actually tell which patients will respond better to low-dose naltrexone and who can't.
Right.
And so what this is really about is just giving us all that more information to be able to counsel that patient appropriately and reemphasize to them how important inflammatory control is, because I will tell you 2 to 3 times a week, I see somebody that I had seen a year or two ago who was terrible. They got better.
Mm-hmm.
They felt great. And they went off of everything. And
then went back down the rabbit
hole. And came crashing down. And they always come in and say, Dr. Stewart, that's really proof that your stuff works.
But, well, I always tell people, if you don't think the supplements are working, just stop them.
Yeah.
And then they go, oh, my gosh, I wish I had never stopped them.
Right.
Because it's harder to get back on the track.
So these are just new SNPs that will add a lot of value. What we're trying to do also is give ourselves better insight
right.
over patient groups. And that's another thing with the lab I want to tell you. We are planning on investing in a next-gen sequencer.
Right.
And next-gen sequencers, if you don't know about them, they basically can map the entire genome of a patient in about 30 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And so those next-gen sequencers are where we can do research. We can look at specific patient groups and start to match
right.
different SNPs for those. And so kind of an artificial intelligence
right.
mapping. And so those are things that are in the future. But these are just some that have really stood out.
Well, these are the
important.
Ones that are going to get people better.
That's correct.
I mean, so you have it, you know, broken down into three sections. Inflammation, cellular, you've got autophagy.
Autophagy is the big thing. And when you have lifestyle changes.
Right, the 12-hour fasting. And
right, and autophagy, 12-hour fasting, 12 to 15-hour fasting is really mm-hmm. important. Exercise is important. And so we also consider certain tests. You know, we want to make sure our microbiome stays healthy. You know, there's just different facets
right.
that you want to kind of take into your lifestyle
mm-hmm.
as because what you're really doing here in most patients is you're assisting them and getting out of a hole.
Right.
And then what you're trying to do is potentiate, and a lot of times diet plays a big role. The microbiome plays a big role. How their eating habits play a big role.
Yeah, and I noticed that, you know, you have the HLA, the DQA1 and 2, which mm-hmm. is usually on the GI part.
Mm-hmm.
You have this in the inflammatory panel.
Yeah, but that's an environmental inflammation.
Ah, very interesting.
So we also have the DRB1 and 2, which actually tells us about people who are highly mold sensitive.
Yeah, you have 29 genes on this panel, but broken down into three categories, which makes it so easy. To, I mean, at least for providers that know what they're doing, you know, it's very helpful. And then the summary page, just
and the other thing with autophagy is we actually are able to tell. Autophagy plays a role in cleaning cells, but it also plays a role in cleaning bad bacteria from the bowel.
Wow.
And so, you know, there are some people that just do better with natural anti-infectives in their bowel all the time. And so we'll be able to tell who those people are.
Wow, that's amazing. I knew we were only going to be able to get through two panels.
Okay.
So you know what? We're going to have a lot more of these that we're going to go by the panels so that we can start to explain how your brain works. Sure. And how the panels can fit into any practices way that they choose for their patients.
Right.
And I think it's a game changer. I'm super excited to launch it. And there'll be plenty of email communication of when the panels will be released, when they'll be available, and the pricing. But thank you, Dr. Stewart, for explaining the first two.
You're so welcome.
All right, everybody. We hope you have a beautiful and blessed day. And thanks for joining us. Bye-bye.
This show is intended for general information and entertainment purposes only. Dr. Stewart serves as the Chief Science Officer and Lead Formulator for Neurobiologics and advises you to consult with your own medical professional on any information given during this programming. This information is not intended to diagnose, treat, or cure any disease or medical condition.